Hi, and welcome to our first week's presentation on the Small Catechism, Commandments 1 through 3. I'm John Sparkman from Holy Spirit Lutheran in the great state of Washington, Kirkland, which is suburban Seattle. Thanks for joining me for a few minutes while we discuss this, and I'm looking forward to our journey together as we all learn together the confessional documents. Here goes. So now that I've caught your attention just a little bit with a fun video, I want to give you a little bit of background information on the Small Catechism and on specifically the Ten Commandments portion of the Catechism. So first, let me give you a quick overview. The great 20th century scholar of the Catechism, Albrecht Peters, notes that Luther's Small Catechism is marked by four aspects. One, it is a brief summary and digest of the Bible, laying out in simple terms the heart of the Scripture's content, that is, salvation through faith in Christ. Secondly, the Catechism enunciates the spiritual core of Scripture, not as the insights of a spiritually gifted individual, but on the basis of Catholic texts. Third, the Catechism looks at the concrete daily life of ordinary Christians set within the context of a coordinate system of creaturely and historical relations. And finally, the Catechism moves Scriptures, the confession of the Church, and our daily lives into the light of the last day. And a couple of things I think to note about the commandments themselves, particularly in their historical context, that these documents can be, or mandates can be viewed more like a binding covenant or marriage certificate between God and Israel. In exchange for protection and favor, God had expectations of the Israelites as expressed in the commandments and passed down to us. But it's important to note that in the original Hebrew, the commandments are not actually written in an imperative syntax. Instead, the Hebrew indicates what one is very likely to do in the future, but it doesn't really clearly translate into our common shall not language that we use. So the commandments tell us about our relationship to God and our neighbor. And in the Small Catechism, Luther begins each explanation of the commandments by saying we should fear and love God. And I think that loving God is a pretty clear aspect, doesn't need much unpacking, but the term fear I think we could spend a little time on. To fear God means several things. First, it means to respect God as the most powerful being and the Lord of all things. Given that, God deserves our respect. But I don't think Luther really wants us to be afraid in the modern sense of the phrase, have fear. As children of God, we fear and respect God because God is our creator and we are his children. We don't need to be afraid. Instead, because of Christ, we can come near to God without fear in our modern sense and with great joy. So, keeping in mind that first clause of each of the explanation of the commandments, we should fear and love God. I'm going to play a nice little ditty for you so that it gets stuck in your head. right. So now that you have that earworm in your head, let's look at the first commandment. The small catechism reads, "Thou shalt have no other gods." What does this mean? Answer: we should fear, love, and trust God above all things. Feel free to sing that along as you're remembering it. So why should we fear, love, and trust God above all things? Because nothing is so great, so dear, and so faithful as the Lord. Anytime you don't put God first, you're putting another creature or motivation into God's rightful place, an idol of sorts, which can take many forms in our modern world. When God said, "You shall have no other gods before me," God is instructing us that the most important being in our lives must be God's will and divinity. Depending on anything else, friends, money, luck, one's own power, all of those things lead us away from God. When and in what ways do you trust in other things instead of God? On the next slide is a little video that I think does a pretty good job of illustrating how easy it is with our modern distractions to have something take the place of God as a central force in our lives. So let me follow along here and play this for you. So with that illustration as a reminder of how this commandment is easily applied to our modern lives, we move to the second commandment, which reads from the Small Catechism, "Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain." What does this mean? Answer: we should fear and love God that we may not curse, swear, use witchcraft, lie, or deceive by his name, but call upon it in every trouble, pray, praise, and give thanks. So here a pattern emerges that continues throughout Luther's explanation of the commandments. He first uses do nots and then some do's. So he sees both prohibitions and things that are required of the Christian in the commandment. So first the don'ts that Luther sees in the second commandment. Don't curse, swear, use witchcraft, lie, or deceive by God's name. So the second commandment reveals that God's name is holy and should be used with honor and respect. We should avoid the temptation to invoke God's name in anger or frustration, or to attribute God's name to actions that God has not taken. Here, in Luther's view, God also forbids making oaths except in church or in courts. We transgress this commandment to say, "I swear by God," or "by Jesus Christ I promise." Jesus instructed us in Matthew chapter 5 to simply say yes or no. Luther goes on to emphasize that God's name is to be used with honor and respect. So in the context of witchcraft, lying, or deceiving, using the name of God in those activities is to transgress this commandment as well. So how should we use God's name? There are some do's that Luther points out. That we call upon, worship, praise, and thank God. Therefore, all kinds of prayer and acts of worship, we use God's name without concern. This is important to note, as in order not to say the name of God or Yahweh in vain, all Jews view this commandment very strictly and do not utter the name at all. But Luther sees that as Christians freed by the gospel shown in Christ, respectful uses of God's name for the purpose of uplifting holiness and the graciousness of God was in keeping with this commandment. So overall, God's name and presence is to be respected as holy and not used for in the context of unholy speech. This takes us to the third commandment. Thou shalt sanctify the holy day. What does this mean? We should fear and love God that we may not despise preaching and his word, but hold it sacred and gladly hear and learn it. Again, we see the pattern of do's and don'ts. First, the don'ts. Don't despise preaching and God's word. And do, hold it sacred and gladly hear and learn it. I think it's important to note here that Luther doesn't talk about a Sabbath day being a particular day of the week. Instead, the exposition of the word and the holiness of the Sabbath can be at any time. It shows his openness to the day on which the Sabbath is held, that it not need to be a set date. And furthermore, in the Augsburg Confession in Article 28, he writes, "For they that think that the observation of the Lord's Day was appointed by the authority of the Church instead of the Sabbath as necessary are greatly deceived. The Scripture, which teaches that all Mosaical ceremonies can be omitted after the Gospel is revealed, has gotten rid of the Sabbath. And yet, because it was necessary to appoint a certain day, that the people might know when they ought to come together, it appears that the Church did for that purpose appoint the Lord's Day, which for this cause also seemed to have been pleasing, that men might have an example of Christian freedom and might know that the observation neither of the Sabbath or of any other day was of necessity." So Luther sees the need for Sabbath, but thinking Christians freed from the law, he doesn't necessarily think that it has to be on a certain day. He expounds on this further in the Large Catechism, writing, "We keep the festival days not for the sake of intelligent and learned Christians, for they have no need of this observance, but first of all for bodily causes and necessity, which nature teaches and requires, and for the common people, manservants and maidservants, who are occupied the whole week with their work and occupation, that for a day they may stop in order to rest and be refreshed. Secondly, and most especially, that on such a day of rest, time and opportunity be taken to attend divine service, and afterward to praise God in singing and prayer. In itself, no one day is better than another, and this should certainly occur daily, but since the mass of the people cannot give such attendance, there must be at least one day in the week set apart. Since from times gone by, Sunday has been appointed for this purpose, we should also continue the same practice, that everything be done in order. The day does not need to be made holy for itself. God desires it to be holy to you. Therefore, it becomes holy or unholy on your account, also as you are occupied on the same day with things that are holy or unholy. So rather than strictly appointing a day, Luther interprets the third commandment as telling us how to worship God. When Luther instructs us not to despise God's word, what does he mean? We despise God's word by not reading it frequently and seeking through the guidance of the Spirit through prayer in our modern age to understand and follow its teaching. Likewise, we should be active participants in worship whenever we find that time and seek to stay engaged as Scripture is shared and expounded upon in preaching. Moreover, when we love and honor God, we will eagerly and passionately desire to learn more about God through study, worship, and prayer. So that's a little survey on the view of Sabbath as expounded in the third commandment, both in the Small Catechism and other documents that we'll be studying this term. So thank you. I hope this has been a fruitful time for you as we talk together about the first three commandments of the Small Catechism. It has been for me, as I was raised in the Southern Baptist tradition, I was not confirmed in the Lutheran Church, and so these documents are fairly new to me, and it's good to be able to explore them with you, and I'm looking forward to continuing that journey throughout the rest of the term. And just a few works that I consulted in the creation of this presentation. Thank you again for your time.